Good afternoon, everybody. Honorable Chief Minister Odisha, thank you very much, sir, for your kind gesture of not only being here and also telling me that you are going to be there. Thank you very much, sir. I will certainly, you made me the Culture Secretary of Odisha, and which really gave me a greater opportunity. And Chief Secretary and Bachi sir and other my colleagues, is indeed a kind of a very strange feeling for me. I should not pretend that I am not truly enjoying that. I am very happy. But I always used to think that when we created this platform, one day, because I've been giving a lot of endowment lecture here, there in the universities, I know that I have an OKH material, I have something to say. But then I know that it may happen sometime, after some time. But back to back, and 15 days back, I left this particular building, again on the same dais in a very different thing. It's really poetic. I enjoy every inch of that. So when I thought that what kind of topic I will speak, I chose a topic. This topic was chosen only about a week back when I was sounded about it. So right to history. I have prepared a small presentation. This right to history, you can see that a couple of images I have captured. One is the Konark, the sun god's. Sun god's image, where he is wearing a high shoe, which is known as northerners' high shoes of Iranian type, with a coat mail, and another Konark panel with somebody is coming from a king coming with an elephant. Another side is somebody is coming with a giraffe, and then the top of that is the Mohenjo-daro's, and basically a kind of before it's totally excavated, it was considered to be a Buddhist stupa. And then people went in search of this stupa only. It turned out to be one of the Bronze Age civilization, which is around 4,500 years from now. And the lowest one is the Kiladi near Madurai. And this particular archaeological survey, in interpretation and other thing, my friends are involved. I'm also in a way involved. I have been writing about it. With this particular background, I'll say that unwritten past and uncertain future. The past leads us if we force it to. Otherwise, it contains us. In its asylum with no gates, we make history, or it makes it. It makes us. It's a marriage's poetry, and this is a kind of choice. Either we make history, or the history makes us. This is a kind of scenario, the past and the unwritten past and uncertain future. It is also what is history is, and again, another important debate. Next. Does history matter? I just want to tell that you must be the Ford automobiles company. Henry Ford I. He once very famously told, history does not matter. Actually, it's a bunk. I say there is I just hardly read history. He said, I will not give even a penny for a whole the history of the world. And then later, Ford changed his view. Okay, I did not say that history is a bunk, but it's bunk to me. It doesn't matter to me. I have no other value judgment. Later, he was so desperate, and in fact, actually, he's become so desperate, and his company went to losses. And then his grandson, the Ford II, he came and redeemed it. So the time and history had the last laugh. And after all, it makes a lot of human history to make an automobile. So that means history matters or does not matter. It's a question still open. History, to me, history not only matters, it is inescapable. Actually, there is no escape from that. All people are living history, which is why history matters. Languages, culture, traditions, religion, and history is not just useful, it is also essential. The study of past is essential for rooting people in time. The rootless people are mostly the ruthless people. We have to root the people in a place. No doubt, history is boring when it's taught by the uninspiring teachers. In fact, I tried, though I gave the history for my civil services, after that, when I truly wanted to be a researcher, I moved here under different universities, but it was not inspiring me. Then I decided to be my own guide. I am an auto run. History is a narrative, big or small, national or subaltern, ancient or medieval, or even modern. History is a narrative. Why actually? It makes the sense that the historians should start with the form. Actually, there's always a debate about the form and content. Whether the content of the history is important or the form of the history is important. People, the technical historian or the people who swear that I am an historian, they give a lot of importance to the kind of the content, the methodology, and the what they want to talk about it. And both the form and narrative become subordinate to that. The forms of history, whether it's a cultural, political, gender, economic, actually it's all the styles. The performance of the past is a narrative itself. History, nutshell to put it, history is a narrative. That's what I'm trying to tell. History is just not history. History is not exact past. There is a person who is writing, he is telling a story. And he has to conceive that what kind of story he is going to tell. I will start. What I am up to? I am now retired, and even before that, I was dabbling with history almost about last 30 years. I will explain where it started. Currently, I am working on Journey of a Civilization from Indus to Vaihai. This is I propose to do it by, if everything goes well, by January. And currently, I am doing history. Why I am using the word I am doing the history? People pretend that as if history is revealing itself. As if history is just showing itself, or history is telling its own story, or history is speaking, which is not a fact. It's a pretension. And people make history, they do history, they narrate history. And there is an element of storyteller in the every history. The form decides what is the content also. I tell you how the form decides. This is a Carton Castle, Simla. 3 days back, I was there. About 3 days before my retirement, I was reading Navarjot Lahiri's book. I accidentally came to know that Sir John Marshall, about which right now I am writing, before the announcement of 1924, September 20th, he announced the Indus Valley Civilization in London. And before that, 3 months before, he had a conclave. The archaeological material from Lahore, Pune, and Calcutta, R.D. Banerjee and M.S. Watts, he asked them to bring it by train. The material was brought to this building. This is the Garton Castle, Simla. Right now, it is functioning as an AG office. Earlier, it was a civil secretariat. In that office, there is an ASI headquarters. He put all the material on table. And Harappa material, Mohenjo-daro material, is 700 kilometers away from each other. And he sees the remarkable oneness. He comes to a conclusion that it is not a localized archaeological survey or material found. It is a part of a larger civilization. The decision to make, as announced this as a decision was taken at Simla. Within next 3 months, he makes the announcement from London. Then I felt the weight of that history. Then I had a need to go to London, Simla. And the entire last week, I was there. I went to this building and managed to get the old sketch of this particular building. And then this is Viceregal Lodge. Later on was known as Rashtrapati Bhavan. Right now, the Advanced Study Institute is functioning from there in an excellent library. I spent last 1 week and basically writing the introductory chapter for my book. And I walked out, and then there is a garden. And this Subodh Kerkar, he is named as the presence of the absence. And this girl, you must be familiar that, is a dancing girl of Indus Valley Civilization. It's a small bronze statue considered to be one of the beautiful work of alloy. And this particular statue, this particular artwork has been put on the rails, the railway, you can say that the rails. Why? Because this civilization was accidentally found by a railway engineer who said there's a lot of bricks are found. He gave an information to the authorities. Then he started with the rail. So this artist has put the dancing girl in the two rails. Then I went there and took a selfie there. The selfie I have not put here. And then again I came back to library and started writing. The breathing the air of Simla, feeling the weight of history in my veins, thinking of Sir John Marshall, R.D. Banerjee and M.S. Watts, I wrote the preface of my forthcoming book there. This particular day and the feel of Simla will be part of my book because that is the narrative. That narrative, why I am calling this a narrative? When I gave a call to the ASI, circle office in Simla, which started in 2005, they were not aware that the Simla had something to do with the Indus Valley civilization. I called up the Chandigarh office to discuss with somebody. They have paper. They were not aware of it. Then I came to Delhi day before yesterday, spoke to people, and they have some data. I also spoke to Lahiri also, and I'm trying to locate some of the correspondence connected with the day. So that means this is what the narrative. That means if I want to narrate you my book, I start with this way. This particular, the choice of the narrative itself is determines what I am going to write. So to that extent, to tell that history is a science or max is not correct. It's only pretensions. No author, no history. It is not written. It is not history. Hayden White, does it really so? If you really go and ask that, what is history? People simply say, what is written is history. As if the writing was not invented. Before that, there was no history. There was no man. There was no culture. Most of the significant things have taken place, which changed the course of the human history, did take place before the invention of the writing itself. Today, you may have the cell phone, but the potter wheel, there was no writing at that time. But then can we say invention of the potter wheel was not part of the history? So then, because it's an academics, the history department wants, or the historians defies that the history starts with the writing. That is the reason most of the country's histories are distorted, because of their connection with what is written. And the story in history is provided by the historian. The past as a history, how far true? It is not true. What historian says is an approximate, is a narrative. It is his viewpoint. The past is the past, and history is a narrative written about it. Only by committing a massive category error can any historian confuse the two. Every history is fictive. It is also necessarily a fabricated, and also a factitious, as well as factualist cultural discourse. It's a fact as well as a fiction. There is a narrative involved. I will come to where I started. I recall that one day in 1988, I was on the way to Raigada to meet one of my senior colleagues. Between Koraput and Lakshmipur, I saw a milestone called Tamili. I got down from my jeep, and I am yet to board the jeep again. I am retired. We both are in this hall. My story started there. And that was, I was telling myself, the village which I am entering, if the tribal village, if the speakers belong to Dravidian linguistic family, I am getting into a new journey. Then if it is not, I am imagining something, I am quitting. They happened to speak to a Dravidian language. I have not got back to my jeep so far. And all other years, I was pretending that I am in government and I was working my job properly, but I am now properly retired. World Cup hockey inaugural stage, many thought, you recall that just 15 days back, many thought it was a dance. In fact, it was not a dance, it was a narrative. It was a visual history. Our tribes on the top of the international stage, it was a history being visually presented. It was a narrative, it was not a dance. Then, when I was in Koraput, I was going through a very relevant. And I was also reading the articles of Ramaya. Ramaya is a person who basically did a lot of history about the rice cultivation in Jaipur side. He was from Coimbatore. He did an article that probably the Koraput region was the cradle of the rice cultivation. There's a lot of candidate. Now the China, Vietnam, Indonesia, there are many areas where it must have started. Then I was going through the Bonda Highlander book of the very relevant and some of the songs he has recorded. In one of the Bonda story, the genesis or the origin stories, there is a story, there's a Bonda's sun god name is Singhi Arke. The Singhi Arke, there is a competition between the Bonda people and the Danagacho, rice, paddy thing. The paddy is coming from here and there, suddenly paddy is coming. Now that this fellow, he is coming and telling the Singhi RK that who is bigger, whether paddy is bigger or a Bonda man is bigger. Then Singhi RK is a sun god and he is the arbitrator. He is having a sword in his hand. He says they will have a competition. I will call out each bonda man. One bonda comes here, and then one paddy. So I say Dana will come and stand there. So like this, I will do it. Who outnumbers? So I will decide that who is the winner. So he calls out bonda one, bonda two, bonda three, like that. It's a paddy one, paddy two. So innumerable thing goes. Finally, still one bonda man is left out. There is no paddy. So then the paddy is declared the loser, and the bonda is the winner. Now the Singhi RK is asking that, what do I do? What kind of punishment? I said, he says, this paddy is having a wing. Because of that, it is not respecting me. Then you have to cut the wings of the paddy. And then Singhi RK puts his sword and cuts both the wings of the paddy. And then from that day onwards, the paddy lost its wing. This is the bonda story recorded by Veri Relvin. I connected that with the domestication of the wild rice. Wild paddy, one day it will be found here, next day it will be, again it will be there. In the wild, suddenly then this fellow is confused that the paddy was there, why it came here? Suddenly yesterday it was not there, but suddenly it is coming there. So whether the same paddy, udikiri podi, like he said, actually it just went by flying. So he was actually, where to go and settle down? Paddy is here also, paddy is there also. He was really worried. And the cutting of the wing of the paddy is the equivalent narrative of the domestication of the wild paddy. In all this cradle of the civilization where the scientific research is going on, such a primitive tribe like Bonda or the counterpart having a narrative for the paddy losing wing, for me is a narrative history. For me is a narrative history. The science and DNA, genome, everything fine, it's a supportive history. I cannot walk past this particular narrative. That is the thing. So 1989, when I was in Koraput, Veri Relvin again inadvertently did a damage. He noticed that there's a lot of homicidal murders takes place among the bondas. He compared with the Italian murder rate, French murder rate in European and American, and then per thousand homicide, and he created an index that the world's highest homicidal tendency bondas having. A judgment was passed. So who is to redeem them? In 1988, I took a permission from the IG prison and met 77 Bonda prisoners, 76 in Koraput jail, one in Angul. I had an interview with them with a clear assurance that I can't help that punishment. So I caught hold of the judgment copy in the district court. I went and met them with the help of one of my staff who was acting as an interpreter, asked their version. The moment I asked them, did you murder it? Come reply, yes, I did it. He is not saying that Mukurunathili. He said Mukurunathili. Then why did it? The reason what is narrated in the documents, in the police document, is totally different from what he says. Sir, I'm a Dujuna Sango. We are friends. We went there. We went to market. Then Asila Volki, he just told some bad word about me. Took Mukurunathili. And another thing that then he was taking my Salapagacharu, he just taken thing and all, Mukil. So there is no motivation to kill. It is not, it's like, there is no mens rea. There is no collective conspiracy. But most of the record what was prepared that some third party witness is giving, that 20 days back he was telling that one day you will come, I have an enmity with you, I will kill you, like that he told. So that eyewitness proved that, so that maximum punishment is given to him. And this bonda goes back to his village. As per the custom, he has to give the 50% of his property as a compensation to the person who is killed. It was a double jeopardy. I was not advocating that he should be taken out of the IPC. But I was trying to tell that this man, we extra work to ensure that he gets the maximum punishment. Even if necessary, we go for the appeal to convert the life imprisonment to the capital punishment. But this narrative of he is being the highest homicidal, it stuck. But they are the inventors of the, or the people who cultivated the paddy here. Even our own tribal anthem. It was a tribute. It is not a song, but it's an history. It's a narrative. That's what Orissa wanted to convey. He thought he saw a banker's clerk descending from the bus. He looked again and found it was a hippopotamus. If this would stay to dine, he said, there won't be much for us. It's a Lewis Carroll's poem. If the hippopotamus of self-styled proper history remains dominant, then I believe it will be difficult for alternatives to emerge. there won't be much room for dissenting voices at the history's dining table. This is what Alun Manshlo, I had an excellent book, I read it. I am bullying the China shop and I love it. Why sun god in Konark sporting horse riders high shoes? Many people have dealt with that. When I dealt with this many years back, I got a letter from K.S. Begara and saying that this should be pursued, this lead should be pursued. Why? All over the India, except few temples in this part of the country, and the Surya as a god is not wearing chappal, South India. But he is wearing a full shoe, horse rider shoe with a coat mail. And this is the question I asked, of course, I found an answer for it also. It's a part of the UNESCO website and the ASI quoted both the articles about the Konark. How giraffes walked into Konark panels? People have written that that the Uriya sculptures, they came to know through some kind of painting of the giraffe. It never happens that way. It never happens that way. Again, I'm not going to elaborate any one of these. Each one is a separate talk I had given, separate article written. I am only to my major theme that history, I have a right to my history. History is a narrative. I'm just using this as a bullet point. Why there are two types of elephants in the Konark panel, one African and Asian? Why Chandrabhaga is on Mu? Why Konark, Modera, Marthan, or even for that matter, even Lahul Spiti near S.P. Thakur's place, where a thing at all. It's in Multan in Pakistan. Wherever there is a sun temple, small or big, why there is a river called Chandrabhaga? This question was not asked before. But this question is very, very pertinent to get the history very rightly and correct narrative. Kalinga in Indonesia, K.S. Begara told me in 1970s, he delivered a talk in Delhi. He mentioned about the Bali Jatra. Then during the interval, during the lunch hour, some history professor told that this is one of the modern Oriya's whimsical thinking, that you feel that you had a great time in Kalinga. Then after reading this article, I still preserve it. K.S. Begara sir told me and wrote to me that now onwards I will not have that embarrassment in any international thing because you have nailed it. And then the Koraput in Nigeria, the genome, which we published in 2003. Right now, I am collaborating with the people who are working on genome, and the genome studies, the Y chromosome and mitochondrial DNA and haplogroup studies are proving that what we wrote is correct. That means what is being told to us as an history is not exactly the correct narrative. The narrative has to be different. This is a comparative toponymy of the identical place name cluster in Orissa and Indonesia. And history of a particular kind, and an history which is particularly kind. He thought he saw a buffalo upon the chimney piece. He looked again and found it was his sister's husband's niece. Unless you leave this house, he said, I will send for the police. Again, Louis Carroll. History of a particular kind is like a buffalo's upon Carroll's imagined chimney piece. And that way, the historians have a very, very peculiar, because I know that there must be some historians in the audience, and I have a good amount of experience dealing with them in different universities, and they have a different approach. Historians under empirical chaos. Engaging with the past is first, last, and always a narrative-making process. Again, I insist that first, last, and always, engaging with the past is a narrative process. When Subrat Bachisar, when first time when he came here, when I introduced him, I use a word I still remember, it's a fairy tale. He has a story to tell. I believe that I have a story to tell. People have to believe that they have a story to tell. Like that, the nations have got a story. Bonda has got a story. He has a story to tell. And then this is the cavity complex. I don't want to elaborate. There's a book, my book is about that, Indus Valley Civilization. The highest, lowest dichotomy about the Indus Valley Civilization now has created important changes in the understanding of the Indian history. History is lyrics. Hayden White's concept of poetics of history understood as a literary artifact. This is a map which I have prepared for my upcoming book. This is the lecture which I delivered sometime back in Chennai on September 20th. This map I have prepared, such map is not existing in the history books. This is the map of the, if you see that yellow type of color, it's the Indus pottery zone. And with the Lothal and Desalpur and the Dholavira, with this beginning of the what is known as black and red ware pottery. The entire peninsular India, the historians have dubbed it as a megalithic pottery. And even before the Indus thing, they just used the word megalith and then just packaged it. They gave us term, it's a megalith pottery. The entire Orissa, Bengal and Assam, what is known as Anga, Vanga, Kalinga, the eastern part, even the lower sides of the Nepal, up completely up to Assam, is again the black and red ware pottery. The southern megalith pottery and the Orissa, Bengal, Assam pottery is exactly same, and it goes and links with the Indus pottery. In between, you see the white space. This is an island of the painted greyware pottery. This is the painted greyware pottery, which is associated with the Vedic culture. The people of that area look down upon the other cultures, particularly the, you know that many people know that the reference about the Kalinga and the Anga and Vanga in the post-Vedic literature was not courteous. It was highly discourteous. Even coming to this area was not considered, not recommended. Even somebody comes here, he has to go back and go through a prayachit. He has to really redeem himself to re-induct it. I have tried to interpret it with the pottery making style and create that particular area which is connected to the eastern zone and southern and the Indus pottery. And this paper, this is what I call is a pot route with a lecture I delivered on September 20th. And this is a song I wrote. In fact, I'm not playing. Why I want to show this one? I was preparing for this lecture. And then on 18th evening of September, so 20th September is the day Sir John Marshall announced the Indus Valley Civilization. We wanted to commemorate 94th anniversary in Chennai. I went for the lecture. And just exactly one day before, it came to me something is still missing. Then I suddenly, me being a lyricist, I suddenly just while coming to office, and my boss also was there sometime, you must have seen my attention is slightly going this side or that side and dabbling with my Samsung memo. I know that he always tolerated me that. And then during these meetings and the car, I wrote here just a 2-minute lyrics. I would have loved to play that, but then it will be a distraction from that. It's a Tamil song, and this is an English translation I given. This is a kind of a tribute to the potters. And then when the meeting started, it was a televised, it was actually done in the video also. Everything we prepared in 30 minutes. A hall like this, vice chancellors and historians and so many people, the intelligentsia of Chennai were there. I asked them to, all of them to get up. The lights were switched off and the song was played as a tribute to the potters. Everybody thought that it's going to be a tribute for the Tamil, mother Tamil, like a Vande Utkal Janani. It was the potter. Next day morning, I was in library. Some potter from Madurai rang me and talking to the librarian. They said that the sir himself is here, you speak to him. The other side, a man was actually crying. He says that in the last 3,000 years or 2,000 years, nowhere, never in India, an elite group of people stood up and gave a tribute to us. I was exactly feeling that. When I did this song, all amount of research, creating map, creating new theory, pot route, I must have worked on this particular speech alone about 6 months. 6 months of research, but still I feel that I still something wanted. When I fixed this song and played it and started with that, I felt that I told in history. Here in the history is the lyrics. That you know how he's responded. About 15-20 days back, after my retirement, prior to that visit, 1 week before my retirement, I went to the same library. The librarian told me that there is a courier for you. Out of curiosity, we have already opened it. Then he handed over this to me, this particular terracotta, small figurine. This is the priest king of the Harappa in the Indus Valley Civilization. He was considered to be a king or a captain or also a priest. So this is a well, all over the world it's known. He created a model and made a clay and burnt it for me. So when I was appreciating that, the director of the library told me, sir, you just see the bottom of that. Then I saw in the bottom of that, I couldn't understand. Then it was told that, he explained to that, it is my name written in Tamil Brahmi. It's a 2,500 years back. This was the script which is being used during the contemporary to Asogan period. He has written, found out the exact alphabet and written it and burnt it and sent to me in a courier, that unknown person, and thanks is a terracotta. So both of us basically both of us were basically dealing with the history. I am dealing with the history. Apart from all research, collecting material, method, photography, all kind of thing, all kind of scientific study, still feel something wanted. I feel that my history study is complete only with the lyrics. But then somewhere that man thinks, then I said, why the name? Probably I am worried. Suppose this is buried. Then sometime after 2000 years back, some historian finds it and tells that this priest king of the Indus Valley's name was Balakrishnan. That will be hilarious. I will ensure that it is not buried. I will keep it in mind. But then if it is found, then that becomes history. But for me, this narrative is the history. So that is a thing. Then I will come back to Bastar. When in 2008 election, 2009 election, 2013 election, I have done three Chhattisgarh elections. Been to all the districts, and particularly all the Maoist affected area, what is called Bastar. For me and our chief secretary, all of us, former Koraputians, it's very close to our heart. Once in a while, we go to Jagdalpur also. So now that district has been divided into Kanker, Sukma, and all these things. I have been to that place. It's a sometime when you fly away in a helicopter, you feel the weight of the narrative and the history. Every time I've flown out of Bastar with an unexplained sense of guilt, I was trying to find out why I'm feeling that way. Prior to 1947, when it was merged with the Indian Union, Bastar was one of the 600 princely states of India. Its size was 39,114 square meter, larger than Belgium, larger than Kerala, but it relatively unknown. Grigson, in 1938, he was the administrator of the Bastar. He is calling them still terra incognita to nearly all British officials and travelers. That means being known to the British officials and the travelers is the criteria. To the ordinary Indian of neighboring districts, this remains the land of savages seeking still for human victims to sacrifice their fetishes, skilled in herbs and simples, and potent practitioners of magic and witchcraft. So Subaltern Sovereigns, Nandini Sundar's book, I kept that quotation. It's a Grigson, 1938, administrator of Bastar. One Dr. B.D. Sharma, he is known to us. Even when the kidnap episode, we used his services, na? Isn't it? He was associated. We have met him in Koraput. He had been to Koraput in 1988. We respect him a lot. He had spoken to me when I was a PITDA. I met him in many associated seminars and other places. He was a former collector of the undivided Bastar. Electronic was a secretary and he was an activist. He became a great activist and fought for tribal rights. He was no Grigson. He had a different narrative. Same Bastar, same administrator, and this man had a different narrative. One day, he was pulled off a scooter by some hooligans, stripped and paraded through the streets of Jagdalpur with a garland of shoes around his neck. They had a different axe to grind. This is the history of Bastar. Different people have found the narrative in the same position, what they found out of it. In the same Bastar, there is an old Parja story. This Parja person is telling the story. The Parja was the elder brother of Raja. The younger, in Orissa also such stories are there. The younger, they were walking along with one horse between them. The younger brother then climbed the horse and made the elder brother bear his burden. Having fallen behind under force, the elder brother, the one who came first, was dispossessed. Subalterns and Sovereigns, an anthropological history of Bastar, Nandini Sundar. This story may look just very innocuous. It sums up. Elder brother, younger brother, Raja, Praja, and he was the owner of the land, and he is the son of the soil. Then suddenly the ruling, the British comes, this comes, that comes. So then Praja becomes the, what is it is. So this is a old Praja story. The Parja storyteller is no historian, but he has a story. That is his narrative of history. The recreated past I quote Werner Sombart. There's a person, he writes about the modern history. In order to make modern life intelligible, I have made a construct which is called Middle Ages. I'm creating something called Middle Age. I mean, talk about medieval period. What is the medieval period? What may have been the actual conditions of that era is a matter of complete indifference to me. And it is ridiculous to claim to refute my theories with the objection drawn from the historical essays. Because I want to define the medieval ages, because in order to differentiate the modern age, don't spend your time in trying to refute me, because it's my whims. And yet all remains. Again, I am more indulgent to poetry. I have a tendency to keep quoting or writing. And yet all remains. I read Walt Whitman. What histories, rulers, heroes, perhaps transcending all others, what laws, customs, wealth, arts, traditions, what sort of marriage, what costumes, what physiology, what phrenology, what of liberty and slavery among them, what they thought of death and soul, who were witty and wise, who beautiful and poetic, who brutish and undeveloped, not a mark, not a record remains, and yet all remains. This is Walt Whitman told about not a mark, not a record remains, and yet all remains. And then that is what the storyteller, the narrative, which I strongly feel when I look at the Koraput tribes or our Bondas, right now the Millet Mission, and everything has got a narrative. There is a kind of history behind it. And then even in our tribes, in the top of the international stage, it is a one way of narrative. We feel aggrieved. There is a story need to be told. And in the history of the scientific history of the Orissa being the cradle of the paddy civilization or the paddy cultivation, this narrative of the Bonda has to be found part of the scientific books as a footnote at least. That is how I am now being a part of the many studies, genome studies. Even yesterday I got a notification where I am a co-author in one of the genome studies paper, because I am no scientist, but they consult me. But I give input from the linguistics and the place names. And then the place names are now found to be a kind of almost a DNA material. It's a linguistics DNA. So place names have nothing to do with the genome. But now the place names being accepted as one of the input for the thing. That is how I am figuring in the Science and Life magazines and co-authoring paper with the great scientist. So that means this input from the Bonda, this narrative from the Bonda that the paddy lost its wing because it was in competition with him. After that, paddy stopped moving. It stayed in one place. For me, is a narrative of the history of the domestication of paddy in India, in Orissa, in the world. So that way, this particular narrative, I consider as an historical input. I would conclude, when every time people, you have to find our own personal life as a narrative. For me, it has been a great journey. And starting with somewhere in the very remote location, I met Airavada Mahadevan. He is a 53 batch IAS officer. He got an IFS. He wrote a letter to Jawaharlal Nehru those days and say that I am a history student. I am lot of interest in the epigraphy. If I go to the foreign service, I may lose my passion. And then is it possible for me to be in the IAS or some other service? He was the batch topper of the country. And then Nehru wrote, I have seen that paper, why not? So that why not was used by the DOPT. The file was not even again submitted. And he was transferred to IAS. And because the topper, he got the Tamil Nadu cadre. He was a sub-collector and other thing and all. Finally, in 1980, he quit IAS. He joined Indian Express Group. At that time, I joined Indian Express Group. I was in Dinamani. We were into the same group for years. Then I quit and came to IAS. When I went to the academy, I was the escort officer when he spoke about the Indus Valley Civilization in the Sardar Patel Hall. And then at that time, I was thinking that one day, will I come to the same academy and deliver a talk about the Indus Valley Civilization? That should be my narrative, not become the collector, this, that, and all. That's a done thing. I'm already in IAS. And then I thought that, will I come to this academy and speak this subject? In 2007, when Satyananda Misra, sir, DOPD secretary, told the Rudra Gangadharan and asked him to invite me to speak on Indus Valley subject. When I went there in 2007, same hall, some other person is my escort officer. And I'm realizing that I am, oh, great. And So I was giving a talk about the Indus Valley civilization. And that was my first talk there, in the same hall. I don't know that if I tell the date, it will sound like an astrology type of thing. I don't believe in it. And then incidentally, it happened to be the same day of October, but forget it. That is just a coincidence. But the fact remains, same hall, same topic. And that person installed something, created something called Indus Research Center in Chennai. When I suffered from cancer, I went to Chennai and joined a company or as a CVO. When I was in study leave, I was called by him to tell that he was getting old, I should inherit his legacy, and he made me the honorary consultant of the Indus Research Center, which I am right now holding. And then there was his last article. He died 15 days back, on 26th day. 2-3 weeks back he died. And then he wrote his last article in 2017 and sent for the J.M. Kenoyer felicitation volume from the export thing. And then he sent this article. Before sending this article, he was worried whether he will live to see this article, last article. He wanted to present that copy, manuscript of that copy typed out, and he wrote this to Bala, whose insight, high west, low east. He claimed that after my 2012 paper and 2016 book, he felt that Indus code has been broken. Indus mystery has been broken. Using that particular lead which was given by me, he interpreted certain things and claimed in the last before, he has told me and died that don't use the word Dravidian hypothesis. Tell this Dravidian. His last about just of September 20th, he came to see my lecture. It was his last public engagement. And then he told this word and he presented it. I framed it after his death and laminated it. And I will hold it forever. It is much, much, much bigger than any award anybody in this world can give it to me. And because I am no historian, but I have my right to history. Acknowledgements for my talk in different corners of the country. Thank you very much. This part in near Vaigai in Kiladi, which is now we are proving that it's connected to the Mohenjo-daro type of thing. This part I call it's a Cleopatra part. When I took this photo, I sent a message to Suja saying that I had taken a selfie with the Cleopatra.